Center and the Ladies Pro Bowler Store welcome you to the Exarvin Coliseum for the championship round finals of the $75,000 Omaha Lancers Open. Hey Omaha, are you ready to rock and roll? Five finalists qualifying in the fifth position. She captured the 1995 Ladies and Legends title with Jim Brenner. From Detroit, Michigan, Cheryl Daniels! Her opponent in the opening match averaged 227.43 for the tournament. From Henderson, Nevada, Wendy McPherson! In the middle position, she is the current Lynch Shoes LGBT Player of the Year from Edmond, Oklahoma, and Marie Dugan! The second seed is the defending champion here in Omaha, from Stuckasana, New Jersey, Mary Ann DeLofo! The tournament leader, who took over the spot after the final game of match play, he's definitely a local favorite, from Lincoln, Nebraska, Ken Strong!
Hi everyone, I'm Leila Wagner along with Dan Smith. Dan, there are nearly 3,000 people expected in this Coliseum tonight. I know there are not enough words to describe the excitement that I am feeling, but the question is, what are the players feeling? How are they going to perform in this atmosphere?
Well, Leila, I think only time is going to tell tonight. We've got a great field, we've got the defending champion and the hometown favorite, but you know, none of them have performed in front of nearly 3,000 spectators. I think the one that can take the energy of all of these people here tonight and feed off of it is the one that's going to come out on top.
Well, tonight is going to be marked in the history books as we are about to begin the first ever arena finals for the Ladies Professional Bowlers Tour. And we are about to begin it right after the national anthem.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise as Teresa Cassaday will sing her rendition of our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. That our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the
we'll be back. match number one between Wendy McPherson and Cheryl Daniels right after these messages. Tonight's telecast of the championship round finals of the Omaha Lancers Open are being brought to you by Fabball, makers of hammer bowling balls and accessories, available at finer pro shops everywhere. And by the Omaha Lancers, excellent in Junior A hockey. In that Starvin Coliseum here in Omaha, Nebraska, Wendy McPherson, Sopranos, ready to start match number one. Dan, now let's talk about how the players got here. They qualified not here in the Coliseum, but at Maplewood Lanes.
That's right. They played 18 games of qualifying at Maplewood Lanes and then 24 games of match play at Maplewood Lanes.
And he's coming up a little bit high, but trips out the 4-pin. So the lane conditions that the players are playing on right now are very different.
They're totally different. It's a different surface, different lane condition, and they just had to adjust. They got an opportunity to come over this morning and bowl on the lanes and drill equipment if they needed to.
And our first look for the evening of Cheryl Daniels. Comes up a little bit light, leaves the bucket. I liked Cheryl's entrance as she came out handing out flowers to the crowd. That was a nice touch.
These players are so excited. This is just fantastic for us to be here.
8-pin fell out at the last minute there. It appears it's not in the bucket as it was.
Right, it fell out right before the rack came down.
And a look at the crowd as we talked about it. Nearly 3,000 people expected. Best 95 finish. She won the Ladies in Legends with her partner Jim Brenner.
And Cheryl's been on a roll. She's made 4 of the 5 telecasts this swing.
A nice percentage. Is there anything she contributes her success to right now?
Not really.
A little bit light again. And this time, the full bucket remains.
She appeared to have a pretty good shot in warm-ups, but again, I think that's going to take a few shots for the players to get comfortable with all these people watching tonight.
Well, you talked about the different surfaces. Now, Maplewood Lanes is a wood surface,
I take it,
and now we're on synthetics.
Mm-hmm. So the conditioner carries down differently and moves around the lane a little bit differently.
And did not finish enough. So she leaves 2. So then there's now trailing and only frame number 2.
See how she's indecisive of where she was going to play. She moved her feet twice to the right. She wasn't sure how much the rail had carried down the middle of the lane, so she didn't know how far right she needed to move her feet.
It's obvious now. Next time, she's probably going to even move a little farther right.
Mm-hmm.
And for the double, Wendy McPherson, solid in the pocket. Dan, Wendy has only bowled in half of the events this year.
Right, she had an arm injury. She had arthroscopic surgery on her arm, and she was off. She went through 2 months of physical therapy, 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. She came back throwing 14-pound equipment 4 weeks ago and just went up to 15-pound 2 weeks ago. So she's really excited to be there. She's worked really hard to come back. And if you saw her just run out that shot, she said, I'm going to play to the crowd. I'm going to try and play it. She's the only one of the players that said they're going to make, you know, they really want to really work towards the crowd here, and maybe she can get him on her side.
And that's a great way to get started, getting the crowd on your side, throwing a turkey right off the bat, and it will be tough against our top player.
You see, she's playing right around the 8th board or so. Ball coming in light, lows the pins out.
And she'll want to get the crowd going because we know our top seed, Jim Straub, is going to be the crowd favorite when she comes on. Cheryl Daniels coming up high now, obviously made the adjustment for the strike in the 3rd frame.
It's very different to not have been able to bowl on these lanes all week because they don't know how fast they're going to carry down, how quickly they're going to change.
A look at the scoreboard. Cheryl Daniels now trailing by 36, can strike in the 4th. She strikes in the 4th. She cut that deficit down to 26. Cheryl Daniels is now heating up the crowd, but we'll have more action from here at that Xarban Coliseum. Don't go away. We're back here now for the Omaha Lancers Open, and as we've had before, Carolyn Dorn is our sideline reporter, and she is with Anne-Marie Dugan.
Anne-Marie, the excitement tonight is enormous down here. Have you done any different preparation for this tournament?
You know, Carolyn, I haven't. We've been really busy today. We were able to ball in the lanes around noon, and I'm just really, really anxious and excited. More excitement than I've ever felt balling the TV finals.
Good. Well, good luck to you tonight. Back to you, Leila.
Thank you, Carolyn. And the excitement is building as this lady right here, Wendy McPherson Kapanos, has opened up with the first three strikes. Let's see if she can make it four in a row. It's
been since 1993 that Wendy McPherson Kapanos has won a title.
That's one of her goals, to win a title soon.
Ball hooking up a little too high. Her string stopped at three. She leads the 3-6-10.
And a little bit of a break there. Actually looked like she didn't get good footing on that shot. She slipped a bit. Again, different approaches than we bowled on all week also.
I think the momentum, to try to keep that momentum up while we take the breaks and everything, is going to also be difficult for the players to keep going.
Nice fair conversion. The camera angles for the first time we've seen.
Fantastic.
During the break that we just had, the reason they sat a little bit longer maybe than normal, we have players warming up because of the unusual format. There's only these four lanes here. There's no other lanes. Normally our players are to the side warming up, the number three, two, and one seeds. So they're able to come on during every commercial break on the alternate pair here, one and two, and just throw some shots to try and stay loose.
Again in the fifth frame, Wendy strikes.
Watch these pins just blow out. Look at the five pin go to the left, take out the seven.
They are dancing everywhere. And Cheryl Daniels, as she doubled as we went away for commercial, had started her own dance.
And really hoping to get that one to try to put any pressure back on Wendy, but comes up a little light.
Right, she was light on that lane. The first shot moved a little bit, came a little high, but tripped the four pin last shot. Tried to move a little back again. Seems to be a real fine line for her on that lane right now.
10 events in 95, 9 caches. Finished second to Robin Romeo in the $60,000 California Classic a few weeks ago. Actually led that tournament by close to 400 pins.
Yeah, it was a shame that when you lead by that much that it changes. And that was in the same bowling center. We had the finals in the same bowling center where she led by those 400 pins, so anything could happen tonight when we're in a total different lanes, different atmosphere.
16 years on tour, 8 national titles.
We mentioned before, one coming earlier this year. Cheryl Daniels starts her string again in the sixth frame.
And Wendy's getting the bowl here in this arena finals, and her dad is going to be at home watching, and today is his birthday. She wanted to say happy birthday to Chris.
What a special present. I'm surprised he didn't come in for this. He usually shows up for special occasions like this.
Definitely something going on with her footwork down there.
Right. It looks like she's slipping. Her foot is going out from under her. A little bit of a wry smile there because she knows she got away with one.
Didn't hurt that shot too much.
Watch her feet. You can see she's still sliding. She's trying to stop.
It's a good idea to stop behind that line. Okay, thank you. Well, when you don't get that correct leverage position and you get away with a strike, you gotta smile.
Three in a row. It's Wendy McPherson. Stefanos in that driver's seat. She leads by 44 pins. We'll be back with the rest of match number one in a moment. And we're back at the Exarvin Coliseum in Omaha, Nebraska for the $75,000 Omaha Lampers Open. I'm Leila Wagner along with Jan Schmidt, and we are about to finish out match number one here. Winnie McPherson Papanos has a 44-pin lead. Cheryl Daniels was working on a strike, leads the 10-pin.
That was a great shot. She really needed that one. She's got to get some momentum going for herself.
We've had all the singing and the band playing. I almost wanted to ask Cheryl, how'd she like to get out there and sing us a song when it's all over? She likes to write and compose her own music. And as you can see, Cheryl trailing by 44 pins. Winnie McPherson looks like she's really got it together.
Seven.
As you said, trying to get the momentum going.
It's not Cheryl Daniels' night. That was an excellent shot. She can't throw it any better than that. Ball just driving a little too hard. Seven pins standing.
It might not be her night, Jan, but it's definitely going to be a night that she will remember.
Every one of these ladies will remember this night, and I hope there's more to come like it.
High game this week, 279, low game, 159. We had six 300 shot at Maplewood Lane. And if tonight someone could get lucky and shoot a 300 game, they would be awarded $50,000 from Sam's Town, our umbrella sponsor of the Ladies Professional Bowlers Tour.
And Wendy's backing off just a little bit. One of the spectators came back into her seat, so she's just taking a break.
Okay, cross is over. Leads the 9-pin. And I guess that's something even the spectators have to get used to doing, is watching bowling in this type of an atmosphere. They don't know that it's...
They were told you aren't supposed to get up and get a drink and come back and sit down while the player is on the approach, but
it's very different because if you could see the layout here, the spectators are down the lane and they're very close to the bowlers.
Oh, lots of hook in the back end.
There's a look, what I was talking about. You see down the lanes, both sides, the spectators are right there, and when they're on the approach and someone gets up and walks by, you just can't miss it out of your eye. It just catches the side of your eye and distracts you a little bit.
Like the thoroughbred racehorses, you need to put blinders on them, blinkers, I believe they call them. Still has a 44-pin lead. Right now, Cheryl Daniels can only shoot 212. Wendy McPherson just has to get some pretty good count, maybe throw one mark in there.
Right, really just good pin count, I think, right now.
And that'll do it. Need good pin count, throw them all. Cheryl Daniels up, she knows the score now.
Obviously, you can't miss the scoreboards here as we are looking at the giant screen televisions as well. I think we have the best seat in the house, Jan.
At the crowd as they are lined up down the side of the lane.
Well, she finally got that lane four. She finally got the carry on that lane. That has really troubled her the whole game. She has had a really good shot on lane three.
To finish out with a respectable score, just she says nothing. You can read her lips, you know, like hits aren't carrying, and that solid 74.
Well, you know, Cheryl Daniels talked to us last night about how you just always have to find the right combination. Got to get the right angle of the pocket and the right ball in your hand. That was really irrelevant. She changed balls and threw at it. But.
And Cheryl Daniels finishes out in fifth place. Check for $3,000.
Meanwhile, Wendy will move on to meet our current or our reigning player of the year, Anne-Marie Dugan.
And we'll see if she can take on Anne-Marie Dugan in the fashion she just defeated Cheryl Daniels. But first, when we come back, Jen, we'll have an interview with a very special guest. Welcome back to Omaha, Nebraska, home of the Exarban, which is celebrating a century of service, along with the Coliseum that we are in, the Omaha Racers, Thoroughbred Racing, and home of one of tonight's sponsors, the 1994 United States Hockey League champion, Omaha Lancers. And we are here in the Exarban Coliseum in Omaha, Nebraska. And, Jan, this Coliseum was built in 1928. It's gone through a couple of remodeling periods back in the 60s and again in 1985. But they host a lot of events here, from concerts to horse racing to rodeos to the Lancers.
That's right. And the Lancers have been here since 1986 until present.
Right now it's match number two. Wendy
starting off this match like she started and finished last match. We saw a quick lane breakdown there.
She didn't lose a thing over the break. She was able to go to lanes one and two and throw some shots in order to stay loose during that break. And Anne-Marie warmed up on lanes one and two and then was able to come over and take four shots on lanes three and four.
What a phenomenal year this lady had in 1994.
What a huge break she just got. Here's a good look at the lady who's had so much success. She has a five-step approach. She's a very up-down arm swing, not really long. Look at that slide she has to the foul line and rips through. You got to take a look at her face. She's very intense when she bowls.
Since 1992 to this tournament right now, Anne-Marie has made the television finals in 31 of the last 71 events. She hits the pocket and leaves the 10. I mean, just some of these statistics that we read on her.
The up-down arm swing I was referring to, she's more of a cranker-style bowler. She's not one of the smooth, long stroker bowlers. She really hits through the ball. She gets a lot of revolutions on the ball.
See, she already won one time this year in the AFSF Challenge.
What I'm talking about. Watch her face.
Boy, does she look determined there.
Watch her all the way through. Eyes never move off her target. Look at that. She puts everything that she has into every shot she makes.
Last title, Sam's Town Invitational. I believe it was in 1993, though. It's my statistic that I have.
But I could be wrong. We'll get that checked out for you, though. Wendy McPherson Papanos now with two strikes in a row.
Right. She actually won the Las Vegas Western Open in 1993.
And that was in February versus our Sam's Town Invitational, which is in November.
Correct.
And that is also Wendy's home. She currently lives in Henderson, Nevada with her husband, Nick. Wendy's been a member of the national tour for 8 years. At the age of 22, she became the youngest woman to win all three major championships, known as our Triple Crown.
Ooh. And it's three in a row for Wendy, just like last game.
Just to mention that Triple Crown was, she won the U.S. Open in 1986, the WIBC Queens in 1988, and the Sam's Town Invitational in 1990.
Emery Dugan with a strike in the first frame, a spare in the second. She went Brooklyn on lane four in frame number one. Crosses over again.
That lane appears to be hooking for quite a bit more.
Our 1994 leader in the point average. She was second in money, though. She was
right.
Surpassed by Alita Phil. And they both broke that $100,000 record as well.
That's right. Alita surpassed her in the final tournament of the year in the Merit Mixed Doubles.
And you can see there the standing so far for the 1995 season. Anne-Marie Dugan leading, seven caches, 46,000. Cheryl Daniels right up there in fourth.
And Anne-Marie trailing by 21 pins. And just to mention that earnings did say as of May 11th, so that was prior to our WIBC Queens tournament. So that does not include any earnings from the Queens last week.
So Kim Kennedy actually will probably be up there a little higher because she was in the top five last week as well. And there's Anne-Marie Dugan's husband, Pat.
And Pat is also Anne-Marie's coach. And she said he really helps her stay in line when she's out here. Anne-Marie's also a member of Brunswick staff, Turbo 2-in-1, and Master Industry staff.
Every little bit helps.
And Wendy is a member of the Fab Ball Pro staff, as well as Pro Sports staff.
Career television appearances, 33. She's 22 and wins, 24 losses. Coming up light, as we saw Cheryl do quite a bit in first game. Moves a 2-5.
And I don't know if she's still having trouble with the footing. It appeared that Anne-Marie made a motion on lane four with a little trouble with her footing also. So that could be what's happening right now. When you don't get good leverage and you are not directly over your feet and you slip or stick a little bit, it's very hard to execute correctly.
No problem with the 2-5 spare. I would love to bowl right now. You have to bowl the event. I thought you told me you were going to bowl in this. I was supposed to try to find someone else to sit up here and commentate with me. What happened?
Thanks for bringing it up. I didn't make the cut. 19-pin lead right now for Wendy McPherson Papanos.
But Anne-Marie Dugan has the advantage with a strike in the fourth, can actually cut that down to 9-10. So Wendy wants to start her string again. Fails to do so, comes up high.
I think these lanes are changing really quickly out there right now. It's like they start to carry down, and then they start to break down a little bit or hook a little more, and then they move in a little more to a fresh area, and that area carries down, and then it starts to hook.
So putting the professionals to the test as Wendy McPherson, Papano, Fair.
She changed balls for that fair, make sure it would slide through the middle of the lane.
Started her career very successfully as Anne-Marie Dugan was named the 1983 Ebonite Rookie of the Year.
Again, can you believe it? She says, hey, okay. Crosses over twice in this game. Look at this, the ball not quite getting all the way, Brooklyn, pretty close, pushing everything back. The six pin topples into the 10. Takes it out just before the wreck's going to come down. We have to get into the fact that Anne-Marie Dugan, there you see now, she only trails by seven, set an all-time scoring record for an eight-game block this week in her second round of match play. She averaged 262 for eight games.
Wow. And she shot two 800s in that block?
Yes, she did. Back-to-back 800s, the first three games and the second three games.
I understand she also now holds the record for the amount of 800s thrown in a season. It was two, and now Anne-Marie Dugan has four. She has shot four 800s so far in 1995, and there's still so many events left.
Oh,
chin. She is trailing by 8 tenths, but I'm sure she'll be fighting her way back when we come back.
Look at some of the stats this week. Size of the field, good field, 85. Average to cash, 213. Average to make match play, 217. Look at that, to make the television show. That could possibly be a record. 226. We didn't have the record books out here for us. It's very good.
Right, I don't know if that was for TV or not. Lanes are really starting to hook for both players right now. Look, she's had really not a lot of trouble on this lane. She's getting the ball out to about the 10th board. And right now it's going to break back really hard. Dead center on the nose.
Not something you want staring at you right now.
Oh! Taking three out of the big four. Would that not have been exciting to see the 4-6-7-10 picked up here tonight? Great effort.
Her reaction. Oh, darn. That was so close.
That was to trying to pick up that spare. That was the reaction to that. Disappointed to leave it and not have a spare, but happy to get so close.
Wendy, leading by 24 pins, now in the eighth frame. 6-10 just sits in the channel.
Okay. Ball not finishing quite as hard as it had been. It looked like she made a move because that lane has been starting to hook.
Wendy has not been shooting too many 10-pins.
No, she hasn't. She's changing to another ball like she did earlier, a harder surface ball, so it'll slide across the lane. No problem with the spare.
Very superstitious player, likes to keep a rosin bag in the same place. So she changes all the time. Does that mean she changes her clothes all the time if she doesn't win?
No, I think she changes the place where she puts her rosin bag each time. If she's bowling well, she'll have it in one place, and maybe the next time she bowls, it's a different place.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And see there, 23-pin lead right now. Match is not over yet, though. You know what I'm noticing? That we've seen a lot of centers. That light hit carries a lot. And other centers.
Right.
Right now, we're not seeing that carry at all. Cheryl Daniels had a lot of problem with this, and now Wendy.
Yeah, see how the ball's coming in light. Normally this 5-pin, see the ball actually deflected a little too much. Normally the 5-pin will go to the left, possibly take out the 7, or the head will go off the wall and take out the 7. But
also brand new pins. Brand new pins never carry as well.
That's right, because the bottoms are flatter. They aren't rounded. It takes more to topple them over.
All right, Wendy spares it up. Emily Dugan has room for 212. She would force Wendy into a good pin count, and Wendy is working on a spare plus. Wendy would have to mark.
There you see the strike in the pocket, I might add, on lane 4.
She made a good move. Moved a lot left with her feet and her eyes. Blew the rack out. Great shot.
Good adjustment after coming up high. Look at the scoreboard. 212, a possibility for Anne Marie. Wendy would have to mark.
What do you think? She's revved up now.
She's ready.
Why, she won 3 times last year. She struck when she needed to.
She's on lane 3, kind of half pocket, blowing the pins out just like the shot before.
And a little reaction from Pat as well. Very emotional husband. Was the one she really needed to go.
That was really important. That would have forced Wendy to mark.
It's Anne Marie Dugan. She's there. She shoots 201. Wendy would need 9 pins on her first ball.
Well, it was a good finishing effort by Anne Marie. She made a good adjustment there at the end. She had to take a chance and make a big move.
It was that big split right there, the eighth frame, that really cost her.
Excellent week for Anne Marie, though. Just, as you see, 9 pins on the first ball to win. Anne Marie did lead the tournament after that great round we talked about. She led it until the last game, until position round. That game, she fell from first to third. So it was a great week for Anne Marie. And
she did have the nice pin count, pinfall for the all of the field as well. She was just lacking in a couple of match games,
right,
bonus pins. So that was the 9 pins she needed. This match is over. Anne Marie Dugan finishes up in fourth place. 3,563. And Wendy McPherson Papanos will be back to meet the next challenger, Marianne DeRupo, our defending champion, after this. Welcome back. We told you we had the best seats in the house, and this is our view from up here in the sky. We are about to begin match number three, final score of match number two. It was Wendy McPherson Papanos, 212, Anne Marie Dugan, 201. Wendy is going to start the match again, and this is the third time she has started the match. Lane breakdown.
7 strikes on lane 3 and 5 on lane 4. She's pretty lined up. I think the problem she's had on lane 4 is when she's had a little footing problem. So I think she's really lined up on both lanes right now.
Oh, and as you mentioned before, though, the lanes had a tendency to be changing. Wendy may have moved in a little bit farther left. The ball did not make it back. She leads the 2-8-10. Jen, how easy is this to pick up? I'm sorry, 2-4-10.
Well, I haven't seen a lot of shots at the left side, so I don't know how much it's hooking for them today. But if she can get it to the left of the 2-pin, throw the 2 over into the 10.
Does not get the ball far enough left to do what you were suggesting. Our first look at our defending champion, Marianne DeRupo. Her first championship round appearance this year. Ended up last year very well.
Last year when she won this tournament, she came from the number 4 seed, so she's got a shorter route to go this year.
And reminiscing of the way Anne Marie Dugan started out, crossing over on lane 4. Also very similar, maybe game styles and the way they like to cross board.
I think Anne Marie crosses a few
more
boards.
I think so
than Marianne. Marianne throws harder. Therefore, you know, she didn't quite throw as hard, she probably would cross as many boards.
I think Marianne, though, likes to see her ball hook and likes to go out and able to play wide like that. Well, critical error there in frame number 1 as Anne Marie Dugan chopped the 6 off the 10.
It was Marianne, and actually the ball never slid. She expected it to fly farther right. You notice she changed to a ball with a harder surface, and it did not fly.
It's hard to hook a boogie ball, but she could do it. The 1992 Ebonite in Bowling Digest Rookie of the Year has 2 national titles. Comes up high again, and she'll get another shot at the 6-10.
And it's difficult to judge whether it's lanes changing or whether it's the pressure. Once we start, you know, these players are getting on here for the first time, making their first couple shots in front of all these people.
See there, she just missed the television final. She bowled super in the doubles. Her partner, Team USA member, Kendra Cameron.
Happy to convert that spare this time.
I may miss it once, but not twice. All right, Wendy coming off of an open frame.
And that was her first open in the 2 matches. So we'll see if she can jump right back on it.
Defeated Marianne DeRupo twice in match play. Must have bowled her in the position round.
Right.
Oh, 6-10. Barely slapped the 10. Does not get it out. That's the reaction you see a lot from brand new pins.
Right. They don't even if they hit it, they tap it, the pin doesn't fall over. See, if pins start to fall, the more they fall, the more they fall, the bottoms get rounded off a little bit more each time. And they fall a lot easier as they get older.
And no problem with the 10 pin. Match now even after two frames.
Wendy would like someday to be named Bowler of the Year. That would be one of her many career goals.
Right, and right now, though, her immediate goal is just to keep bowling. I mean, she's really happy that she's able to bowl. It was a long time off, and she's, you know, really excited about bowling again. And again, the light hit you mentioned, Leila, is not carrying.
And there's a look at John Falzone, the LPDT president.
And sitting next to him, Lisa Summer, our LPDT director of operations.
Everyone's out for this fine event.
Bring in all the dignitaries.
And Wendy converts the 7-pin.
So the open really didn't seem to affect her out here. She came back with two good shots, just didn't carry. Marianne, on the other hand, has been high twice, so she's going to have to make a move left and see what happens.
High game this week, 300, one of the six that was shot.
Oh, and she crosses Brooklyn on lane four.
And a look at position by round. Marianne actually going the longest, all the way from 42nd after round one to second, the farthest. Kim Straub also made a big move. Most consistent appears to be Wendy.
And she's also very consistent tonight so far.
She was trying to capitalize on that Brooklyn break. Again, crosses to the left of the head pin. This time leads the 310.
Wow. Looked like she changed balls on that shot also, and that ball hooked just like the other.
And a lot of the ladies who toured this week couldn't wait to get into the crowd and see what it was like here tonight. Obviously, they'd rather be out on the lanes themselves.
Marianne Cirupo converts the baby split. She still keeps the lead by one pin, but it is tight here at the Oxarbon Coliseum. We'll be back with more action.
While we were away, no one threw any strikes. Conditions are turning out to be a little bit of a puzzle, but the match is still very close. Marianne Drupo now up in the eighth frame. Meanwhile, Carolyn Dorn is down with Kim Straub, our top seed. And as soon as Marianne finishes the shot, we will go down to Carolyn.
Kim, you stated in your interview that it is not your game plan to play to the crowd. Watching some of the other girls play to the crowd, has that changed your attitude at all?
No, not really. I think I'll still just be myself, and if they get excited, then I think it'll help me to be more excited than I normally am, but I like to try and keep my emotions under control. That helps my game better.
Well, good luck to you tonight.
You.
Back to you, Leila. Well, you heard her game plan. I'll have to see how it works. And that'll be coming up in the next match. Right now, though, Wendy McPherson-Papanos looks determined as she tries to get a strike
on lane four, and she does so. She has a 4-pin lead.
While we were away, Wendy left the 4-6-7-10. Watch what happens on this shot.
You know, you never see the 6-pin slide straight across. Look at this. The ball's barely touching the 6. It's going to topple over. Hit the 4. The 4 wants to go. Oh, just misses the 7. But those pins, the 4 and the 6, are directly across from each other. In order to hit a pin light enough to get it to go straight across the lane is nearly impossible. Very rarely do we ever see that.
And we almost saw Anne-Marie Dugan pick that same split up earlier tonight, but she got the 6-7-10 and left that 4.
That's right.
Hi again.
You mentioned puzzling lane conditions. Both players, while we were away, having trouble with the lanes beginning to hook on them, going high on most of their shots. Wendy made a move on lane 4 and made a great shot. Lane 3 again, starting to hook. Marianne Drupal also left a split on lane 3 while we were gone. So appears that lane 3 is breaking down now the way lane 4 did a little bit earlier.
And Marianne, as you can see, just with her head down, trying to keep her own game into perspective. Wendy Spears still leads by 4 pins, but her family Duplo is working on a strike in the 8th frame. She can shut out Wendy by throwing 3 strikes. And a look at the 300 games this week. Both the Doran sisters, Kathy and Carolyn Schott, and roommate Tammy Turner as well. Well, it's not a shutout situation here as Marianne goes wide, obviously making adjustments there. She's been going through the nose on lane 4.
Right. She made a move there. She had to try because she's been punching the nose just like Wendy did a couple of shots. So.
All right. Maybe I will retract the statement I said. I'd like to be bowling down there right now. Right now, I don't think I would.
They look like they're a little tough right now.
Converts the 1-2-8. All right, whatever she does in the 10th, Wendy is going to have to match her. So if Marianne can double, Wendy would have to double.
That's right.
Look at the scoreboard.
4-pin match. Right now, Marianne's mom is at home. Really praying for Marianne, and Marianne wants to send that right back. Her mom had some serious back surgery and is recouping at home. She says, I miss you, Mom. I wish you were here with me.
And Marianne, originally from Secasana, New Jersey. That's where her mom lives.
Okay, if she spares here, Wendy will have to get a mark also. And pretty good pin count.
So not a high-scoring match, but a very close match nonetheless. Marianne does spare. She will force Wendy to spare. Finishes out with 170.
Wendy's going to need a mark, and it would depend on how many pins she gets on this first ball, and then gets a spare, how many pins she would need on her fill ball then. So we have to wait to see what she does right here.
Pin count critical. She leads the 2-5. Still not quite over. Marianne Drupal now looking up. It's out of her hand.
So she'll need a spare and 8 pins. Wendy wanting to make sure she did not go high on that shot. Leave something she can pick up. Ball was a little bit light. She wants to take both pins with the ball right now.
So, as you mentioned, Dan, right now she needs 8 pins. 7 would tie.
mentioned, Jans, who is afraid of going high. We have a tie in match number three with a 170 game. The players will go right into a two-frame roll-off. It's considered the ninth and tenth frame. Wendy is up right now. This is be marked down on a scoreboard as the ninth frame. This is the year for ties and roll-offs. We had a double roll-off in the doubles tournament.
Right, we did. Kim Adler and Nancy Fair wound up winning that one against Anne-Marie Dugan and Stacey Ryder.
That's right. At the pins on that one, yeah. She says she just diced the rack.
Well, you know, she had to make a move, on lane four, because she came so light, she almost left a six count on her first shot in the 10th frame. So she had to move a little bit to make sure she would hit the pocket a little more solid. Just a little too much, apparently.
Shot, six pin just sits though in the champ. And again, Mary Andrew, but look what happens when the pressure is put on these players. They just respond so greatly. I mean, Mary Ann gets up there and makes a super shot, and she really hasn't hit the pocket.
Well,
except once on that one.
That's right. They have to just go for it though. This is it. It's sudden death. It's now or never. So they're making moves. They're taking chances that you might not take during an entire game.
And picking up the spare, Mary Ann Drupa will now move over to lane three, where she will perform basically a 10th frame. Through the nose.
Okay, fortunate to break up a split there, though. She tears this up. Wendy's going to need the mark.
I've heard this before. Well, this is great excitement for the 2,835 fans we have. We got the official tally, and I was very close when I predicted 3,000.
And Mary Ann drew both spares. Okay, if she fills this up and strikes, it'll be 38 posted for the 9th and 10th frame, which would mean Wendy would have to get up and mark and then get 9 pins on her fill ball.
And there's a look at the scoreboard. An abbreviated version.
High and another 8-pin count. 36 for Mary Ann Drupo. As you mentioned, Wendy McPherson Papanos is going to have to mark. So if she spares, she would still need good pin count. If she could strike here, then pin count wouldn't be as important. She would need only 4 pins.
And it's the 7-pin that remains.
Okay, she'll need a spare and 7 pins to win.
There's the 7-pin. Now she must have 7 pins on this shot to win. Should I say it? I said it last time.
Don't do it.
Don't do it. Don't tell them 6 ties. No, we're not going to have 2 roll-offs. Mary Ann Drupo, what do you think she's thinking?
Good six?
Just give me another chance is what she's thinking right now.
The match is over. It's Winnie McPherson Papanos moving up into the championship match. She'll take on the hometown favorite, Kim Straub. We're back now for the championship match of the $75,000 Omaha Lancers Open. We're at the Ex-Garvin Coliseum here in Omaha, Nebraska. Kim Straub, our top seed, is now getting ready to take the lanes, and I would say she is the crowd favorite.
That's right. She's from nearby Lincoln, Nebraska, about 45 minutes from here.
Member of the Nebraska Bowling Hall of Fame. Oh, no. Comes up high in her first shot of the match.
And she pulled that a little bit from where she was playing during a practice shot. Kim is wearing red and white for Nebraska tonight.
That's loyalty.
Gives it a run, but goes out with nine.
Good effort. Now, as Wendy comes up, I want to mention that during the break here, we've all been treated all night to some wonderful music by a band led by Johnny Ray Gomez. Thank you. Great job.
And a lane breakdown very even for Winnie McPherson Papano.
She's had one more frame, really. Finished on lane four one more time than lane three, but
pretty even. As you mentioned, we were entertained also by a couple of the Omaha Lancers mascots, Blades the Rooster, and Lance has been keeping the crowd pumped up during the break. And Wendy crosses over, leaves the 10-pin.
Wendy had had trouble recently. There was the two opens on lane three. Lane started to break down for her. That could have been Kim's decision for starting to make Wendy finish on lane three, or Kim might like her shot on lane four a lot better.
Well, that's right, because Kim's actually going to have the pressure on her to finish this match, which is unusual. Since Kim's been a three-year member out on here on tour. She has two national titles, but I wouldn't consider her to be a veteran television finalist, yeah. Years on tour for Wendy, 8-5 national titles. A native of Walnut Creek, California, now resides in Henderson, Nevada. Wendy McPherson Papano crosses over again, leaves the baby split.
And again high on lane three. And she's trying to figure this out right now, what kind of move she needs to make on that lane. She went through this with lane four a while back. Now she's trying to make the same adjustments on lane three.
Did they use the same oiling pattern as they did at Maplewood? Do you have any idea?
I don't believe they used the same oiling pattern because that was wood, and they had to use a spray gun in the heads of the lane in order to get it to hold up. Here they didn't want to do that here, so it is a different pattern.
All right. Textbook style right here.
Great conversion. Taking both pins with the ball. Yes.
Kim Straub trying to bounce back after an open in frame number one. She did not get any revolutions on that ball at all.
No, you see her motion. See, she's wiping her foot. See that? That's a good thing to do if you're at home and you're sliding a little too much. Mm-hmm. Wipe the bottom of your foot with a towel. To take off any residue that might be on it. Also, if you rub your foot on a carpet, it'll create some friction. You might not slide as much.
One title from the number one position came in 1994. Kim Fair, so she moves on to frame number three.
But Kim has made it to only two championship matches, the final round of the championship match, and she's won both times.
Good odds. Kim right now a part-time player. She's recently married Bill Straub, former PBA player, also coach of the Nebraska University team.
Okay, she made the adjustment there. She came high last time. She had to trust it on that lane, and she's light. I think right now she's battling a little nerves. She's got a lot of family and friends here. She said it's very good for her to have family and friends. They've been looking forward to her, to seeing her on a television show.
And there's a look at Bill Straub. Boy, it's got to be hard sitting back there. He wants it so bad for him.
Oh. All right, Kim Straub bears in the third frame, but she still trails by 11. We'll be back with more of the championship match in a moment. We're back now. While we were away, it was back-to-back strikes for Wendy McPherson Papanos, and here's a look at the two of them. She's made an adjustment, got herself to the left and opening up the lane, throwing the ball to the right. Flush. Here's the next one on lane three. Same shot out to about the 10th board. Flush.
Next shot there was live action. Kim Berkey looks up, says finally. Crowd goes wild here. Husband Bill's going wild. Come on, there's still time, he says. We can put together some strikes and finish off this match. I'd like to apologize for us having to bowl through some of the match here. We do not like to do that in a championship match, but due to a time constraint and we had that roll off and just were unable to fit it all in. 86 LPPT Rookie of the Year. Trying to make it three in a row, came up high.
Okay, it looks like she actually flipped off of that shot. When that happens, her shoulder falls to the right, the ball gets away from your body, so you're actually setting the ball down farther to the right than you did the last shot. That looks like what happened there. She set it down closer to the dry area.
Tried to give it a run again, but she turned over the lead to Kim Straub. Now I take it back. It's still Wendy with a two-pin lead. We'll be back with more after this. And we're back now, back to work for Wendy McPherson Papanos as she still has the lead, but by only 5 pins. That was a strike in the seventh for Wendy.
She finally carries that light hit that we've talked about all night and hasn't been falling. Ball coming in pretty light on the head pin. It goes off the wall. The ball barely touching the 5 pin. Head pin taking out the 4 and the 7.
And there's that reaction. Yes. All right. Trying to increase her lead to 15. She can do it if she doubles right here.
Now on Kim Straub. Great shot by Wendy. She just really had to make sure she got leverage and extended the ball down the lane. This looks like the two shots she made in the third and fourth.
I think she definitely feels like this tournament is in her grasp.
6-3 record on television for Kim.
In her sixth appearances. And Kim Straub strikes again on lane four now. And this is what we like to see. A close championship match. And to top it off right here in the Oxenden Coliseum for our first ever arena final.
15 pins right now, Kim trails by. She could cut that to 5 pins if she strikes now in the ninth frame.
95 average, 209 as a part-time player. Last year's average, a little bit lower. And fails to hit the head pin.
She's shaking her head. She knows she did not make a good shot on that one, but she's going to try and convert the spare because the match is not over yet.
4-time All-American. 3-time Academic All-American. And she converts the spare.
There she is on her first shot, coming straight at you. She let that out. She knows it. Look at that. Just that slide.
This game, this title right now is in Wendy's hands. She is getting ready now to step up in the ninth frame. She could punch it to the wall and walk away with the check and the trophy.
Oh boy, watch this ball. Driving really hard, hitting half pocket, blowing everything out. Wow, what a reaction. Okay, look at the scoreboard. Wendy now leads by 25 pins. Kim Straub can only shoot 193. If Wendy gets 9 pins on her first ball, she is the winner. We'll be back to talk with Wendy and the presentation right after these messages. Tonight's telecast has been brought to you in part by the Omaha Lancers, excellence in Junior A hockey. We're back with the champion, Wendy McPherson-Papano. Final score 225-179, and we have a lot of presentations to make tonight. And the first one is from John Battiato. He is the proprietor at Maplewood Lane. John?
Wendy, I want to present you with this lovely crystal ball, and we'll see you again next year.
All right, in the second presentation, we have another trophy. It's Ted Baer, the president of the Omaha Lancers. Ted?
Wendy, congratulations on the first arena finals win.
Thank you very much.
And I don't know what's more important to you, Wendy, the trophies or the check, but here comes Jeannie Bielet. She is the proprietor also of Maplewood Lanes. Jeannie, you have a check for $13,500. Jeannie?
All I can say is enjoy and come back. I will enjoy, thank you.
Real quick, I'd like to thank Jeannie and John and also Ted Baer. This was an absolutely incredible experience, and without you all, it wouldn't have been such a great evening. Thank you very much for your support, and hope to see you next year here. Wendy, real quick, how hard was it to focus?
Actually, it was pretty easy because you were enjoying the crowd, and they were real quiet for you when you bowled, and they were a pleasure to hear their applause.
All right, a fantastic performance of a fantastic champion. So long. This concludes the LPBT Spring Tour on Time. We hope you enjoyed it. Look for us in July when the summer tour begins in Newport News, Virginia, with the Quantum Technologies Old Dominion Open. For Jan Schmidt, Carolyn Doran, I'm Leila Wagner. So long, everyone.